On our desert island this week is the celebrated English composer Sir William Walton. How good would you be at enduring loneliness? For most of your life you seem to have lived away from cities and crowds.
Yes, I think I wouldn't be too bad, actually, once I got used to having no Robinson Crusoe.
Now, you've got 8 records, and that's all.
Mm-hmm.
Did you find them very difficult to choose?
Not really, no. I thought of things from my childhood, you know. I thought, what have I sung at that date? So I chose this one by S.S. Wesley.
What's it called?
The Wilderness.
Yes, of course, you were originally in your father's choir.
Yes, I
in
was.
In the church. That was in Oldham.
That was in Oldham. I sang it there.
The closing passage of The Wilderness by S.S. Wesley, sung by the choir of St. John's College, Cambridge, directed by George Guest. Do you have a big collection of records, William?
Well, fairly big, yes. But I don't seem to play them very often. Just lie under the dust.
Have you kept your old ones?
They are somewhere about. I know where they are.
Going back to Oldham in Lancashire, your childhood, both your parents were singers, weren't they?
They were, yeah.
And you went to the choir school of Christ Church College, Oxford. How did that come about?
Through my father seeing an advertisement in the Manchester Guardian or something.
As simple as that?
Yeah, simply. And seeing I better have a try at it.
How old were you?
About 9, 10, I've forgotten.
And of course you had to audition. Did you find that very frightening?
Well, the questions they asked me, I'd never done anything of the kind, singing the middle note of 5, you know, and that kind of thing.
Yes.
That's rather surprising, but I did it.
Well, you were accepted, and of course you must have felt rather a long way from Oldham. You had a Lancashire accent in those days. Were you teased for that?
Oh, yes. My first term was absolute hell, from that reason.
Were you made a soloist fairly quickly?
Well, not fairly quickly, really. I mean, 2 or 3 terms, I think. And I sang in that Wesley you just heard.
Well, that was fine. You knew it already.
Yeah,
that
I
was
knew
an advantage.
It was a great phenomenon. Then I happened to have sung practically all the anthems they had.
You began to compose as a youngster, didn't you?
Well, I was about 14.
Mm.
Or late, actually.
Late to start composing, do you think?
Well, I mean, yes. Others, you know, generally on their mother's knee.
You were allowed to stay on for a while after your voice broke.
Yes, they didn't know what to do with me quite. And as Dean Strong was a great Dean of Christ Church, was a great man for encouraging any talent there was about, he encouraged me.
And after your extra year, or however long you were allowed to stay on there, you went into the college itself.
Into the college itself.
As a very young undergraduate.
Yes.
So virtually you went straight from prep school to university.
Yeah, well, yes. I had no intermediates, a sort of public school business.
Mm-hmm.
Thank God, I think, probably.
And you read music, of course. Did you get your muzz back?
I didn't, you know. I failed in composition.
Oh, no. You sailed through all the rest?
Yes. Sailed through all the rest.
Let's have your second record.
That is Barenboim playing Mozart A major.
Why do you choose this one? Has it any particular significance or story for you?
No, it's just a piece I happen to like very much.
Thank you. out of the first movement of the Mozart Piano Concerto in A major, number 23, K488, the English Chamber Orchestra with Daniel Barenboim. So, Sir William, you were sent down from Oxford because your compositions were no good.
That's right.
What happened to you then?
Well, I was luckily made great friends with Sasha Sitwell. He was at Baylor at the time. Oxford filled in very quickly, because if you can get into the university, you got out of the army, so to speak. So
yes,
it was very popular, because everyone wanted to get out of the army. Whatever else they wanted to do, they wanted to get out of the army. So it was full of interesting people like Sasha Sitwell and the Actons and all that.
Mm-hmm.
And I made friends with a lot of them.
So you were in the attic of the Sitwell's house.
Yes.
Now, despite the thumbs down of Oxford, you were determined to be a composer.
Well, it was the only thing I could do, actually, satisfactorily.
Had you had any instrumental training?
No. I did try to teach me the piano, but not much luck.
And you had a work played at the Salzburg Festival almost at once.
Well, that was a string quartet which I'd been working on for years. A horrible piece that consisted of sort of snatches of Schoenberg and Berg and Bartok and all the bees, in fact.
It's never been revived. It's one you prefer to forget.
I have got a copy, but It's never been shown to anybody.
And shortly afterwards came that celebrated event, Facade. That was first performed quietly in the Sitwell House, wasn't it?
That was done not so quietly either, really. Because though the audience was invited, it was quite noisy about it, even then.
Settings of Edith Sitwell's poems. And then, of course, it was transferred, as it were, to the Aeolian Hall. Now, that was particularly noisy.
That was very noisy, yes, indeed.
Why was that? I mean, was it engineered in any way, or was
it... No, it wasn't engineered, but they weren't very popular, the Sitwells, even in those days. I think Osbert went out of his way to be rather unpopular.
Mm-hmm.
And Edith. The only one who was sort of really tame and quiet was Sasha.
Yes.
And rather resented all that.
And Edith was reciting through a kind of funnel through the curtains, wasn't she?
Yes, that she was.
Now, of course, the facade pieces have become exceedingly popular.
Yes.
I mean, you've done very well on them through the years.
I have done very well on them. So is she, I think.
And shortly after that, there was a composition in three movements of which you dedicated a movement each to the three Sitwells.
Oh, yeah, the Sinfonia Concertante.
I suppose your oratorio, Belshazzar's Feast, was your real breakthrough.
That was the real breakthrough.
Is it true that some of the choristers threatened to quit because they found the music too difficult?
Well, I was told at the time, so then I've been told lately that it was quite untrue. They all sang it at sight.
Oh, well, it was rather a complimentary thing to say to you.
Yeah, yes.
What are we going to hear next?
Ose a Fork.
From Facade?
Yes, it's one of three poems that I turned into songs.
Mm-hmm.
They weren't very successful because everybody found them very difficult. The only person who could sing them is Kirite Kanawa.
Oh, she's a delightful singer. I'm looking forward to hearing this.
Intelligence. She is the only girl I've heard who could get anywhere near them. And she gets beyond being near.
A Fork, sung by Kirite Kanawa. As a young composer, Sir William, which English musician influenced you most, do you think?
English musician?
Yes.
Well, I was great friends with Constant Lambert. Now, I think in a way he did influence me, though not his music, because, remember, he wrote the Rio Grande.
Yes, indeed.
Which was very successful. I can't say it influenced me, but I got a lot of ideas from him, you know. Mm-hmm. I mean, we were great friends.
Yes, he had a wonderfully lively
yeah.
mind.
Yeah.
Some of your early compositions were, of course, commissioned, some of them by the BBC. Are you one of those people who have to have a deadline before you can deliver a new work?
Well, no, I'm not. I'm no good at that. I became good at it later on when I took to film writing.
Yes.
But till then, I was very, very slack about when I finished a piece.
Your oeuvre is not a very large one, is it?
Not at all.
How many symphonies?
Too many. Two.
Now, the first had its premiere performance without a last movement. Why was that?
Well, I couldn't finish it, that's all.
It was already announced, and
yes.
It wasn't ready.
It wasn't ready. Simple as that.
Did it make a great difference? Was there a scandal about it?
Slight. The only person who really stuck up for me, strange to say, was dear old Vaughan Williams.
Mm-hmm.
He said, all right as it is, leave it alone. But as I'd really more or less finished the last movement, and needed another month or two to work on, I went on later. I think I was right.
One full-length opera, I believe, that was Troilus and Cressida.
Yes.
And, of course, a set of concertos.
Yes.
If only one of your works were to survive, and that's looking at things very pessimistically, which one would you like it to be? Which one of your works do you think is true, Walton?
Very difficult to say. But I think the violin concerto I'd miss most myself on my desert island. If I hadn't got any recollection of that, I'd be rather sad.
Well, it is one of the records that you've chosen among your eight for the desert island, so I think this is the time to play it, as You mentioned it.
I think it is.
And I know that your favourite recording is by Heifetz, and it's the recording that you conducted yourself. Which part of it shall we hear?
I think the last movement.
The opening of the last movement of your concerto for violin and orchestra with Jascha Heifetz as soloist. He was the first soloist to play the work, wasn't he?
Well, he commissioned it, actually. It was his work. No one else had ever asked me to write a work for him. So I was delighted and flattered, especially when he took to it. You see, he had asked other people and turned the works down. I should hate to say who they were. I may I say they're very well known. But they didn't pass his scrutiny.
Yes.
He made it very difficult.
Your films brought your music to a very wide public. I believe it was Paul Zinner who discovered you, as it were, as a film composer.
Well, it was a chap called Dallas Bauer who worked with Zinner.
Yes.
And he suggested to Zinner that I should do with the music. There's a film called Escape Me Never with Elizabeth Bergner in it. And I had no idea what the hell I was up to at all. I had never thought of writing film music. I didn't know how to, you know, how to do 5 minutes there, 2 minutes there, a second there.
A tremendously disciplined form of writing.
It's a marvellous discipline.
How far into the production did you like to start work? I mean, did you like to start working on a rough cut, or did you...
I just went and saw it so often. Also, I rather enjoyed going down to Denham.
You wrote the music for two or three of Elizabeth Bergner's films.
Yes, I did. I've forgotten which.
Well, including Laurence Olivier's first Shakespeare film, As You Like It.
Yeah.
And you did some Ealing films during the war.
I did a lot of films during the war.
And the first of the few for which you wrote the Spitfire Few.
Yeah.
Thank you. Was it as a result of having done that early, As You Like It, that Laurence Olivier asked you to do the music for Henry V?
I don't think directly, actually, but as a help. Yeah, that he remembered that I had done it when I suggested.
It has surely become the most famous film music suite of all time.
I don't know the most famous, but I mean it has become quite famous.
And you followed it with Hamlet and Richard III.
Yes.
Have you done any since then?
No, I haven't.
Number five to be?
Talking about number five, Sibelius number five.
The Fifth Symphony?
Yeah.
Why do you choose that?
Well, it's one of my favourite symphonies, even more than Beethoven five. and it's very accessible. And it had a great influence on me, really.
Mm-hmm.
More than Beethoven, if I even have.
Who is performing this version?
Karajan. It's a wonderful recording.
The closing passage of the Sibelius Fifth Symphony in E-flat major, Herbert von Karajan conducting the Berlin Philharmonic Orchestra. During the war, Sir William, you were an ambulance driver. You liked driving motor vehicles rather fast, don't you?
Well, I did later, but not then, because I couldn't. It was a double D clutch. I didn't drive anyhow. Several ambulances, I'm afraid, smashed under my delicate fingers.
Oh, dear.
So I was asked not to continue.
They took your ambulances away
from you? Away from there. And said, you better write film music instead.
Thank you. was about 30 years ago, I think, that you elected to retire to a quiet island. I don't mean retire literally, but to go away to a quiet island off the Italian coast. Have you enjoyed that peace and quiet?
Very much. In fact, it's changed my whole aspect of life.
Mm-hmm.
My wife's a great gardener.
Your garden is famous.
And I got involved with it, you know. I know nothing about it at all. She knows a lot. And we had the luck of getting hold of Russell Page to design it.
Now, you're a quiet man, Sir William, but your music bubbles with excitement and energy. Do you feel that excitement when you write?
I suppose I must do. I can't remember. And I haven't written an exciting work for some time.
Are you still hard at work?
Well, I wouldn't say hard or work, but I have written.
Your most recent works you've written for Rostropovich. You met him in Russia, didn't you?
Yes, I did. But lately I've become great friends with him.
When did you go to Russia?
Oh, some years ago.
What was the occasion?
We were invited by the LSO to go.
Mm-hmm.
A very rare sort of privilege, I thought, for me and my wife to be guests of the LSO. And the Russians were rather flabbergasted by this. In fact, they couldn't get over it at all. That a composer should be invited to Russia by the orchestra. I mean, not the thing to do at all. Only capitalist countries could do such a base thing. Anyhow, I got to know Rostropovich quite well, and he asked me to write a work for him. And I said, you never played my cello concerto. You played everybody else's, but not mine. And he said, you do me favour, and I do you favour. You write new concerto, and I'll play both old and new ones.
Fair enough.
Fair enough. But I didn't write a new concerto. I was too much trouble. And I wrote him this piece for a solo instead, mm-hmm. which has given him more trouble, really, I think, than me. But he played it marvellously. He played it to me last night. He's a marvellous, intuitive interpreter.
You've been collaborating with Alan Bennett on a one-act opera.
I wish I had.
Hasn't it got very far?
Got at all.
Because you've already done one actor. It'd be rather good to have another to make a complete evening.
And it's very difficult to find the right subject. And he's a very good person. I think I could collaborate with him very well.
Yes, he's a very amusing man, too. Yeah. Nice man to work with, I should think. Let's have another record. What have we got now?
Well, talking about opera, I'd like to have a go at Puccini, who's really almost my favourite.
Mm-hmm.
Puccini and Verdi are my two operatic favourites. And a Tosca or anything like Butterfly.
Well, you choose.
I think Tosca.
Tosca. And which part of it and who shall sing it?
Placido Domingo. A marvellous singer. In the beginning of the third act.
Placido Domingo singing the great tenor aria from the third act of Puccini's Tosca. Well, let's go straight into your seventh record, Sir William. What's that to be?
Well, it's going to be by my friend Hans Henzer. And he's also a great opera composer. You know? This isn't actually from any of his operas, but there's five Neapolitan songs. And they're wonderful songs. I'm afraid we've only got time for one, but he's a very, very extraordinarily good composer. I think the best of our day, almost. All'acqua, all'acqua del fontanelle, addoci vanno li
The second of five Neapolitan songs by Hans Werner Henze, All'acqua di le fontanelle. Gardening being a hobby of yours, you're on this miserable island all on your own, but you could cultivate some vegetables or something to eat.
I suppose so. Strictly forbidden in our garden, I may say.
Vegetables. No vegetables at all?
No, none at all.
Haven't you a vegetable garden behind some bushes somewhere?
No, no.
All that beautiful garden, you have to go and buy your vegetables.
I go and
buy. Oh, dear.
Well, it's much easier, you see, than having a special bit of garden cut off to grow horrible vegetables.
Do you like small boats? If a suitable small craft were to be discovered...
I'm not really any good on the sea or in the sea, actually.
Well, we'd better stay where you are on the island. We'll come and fetch you.
That's better.
Right. Well, while you've been here in London, there have been all the festivities and celebrations for your 80th birthday, which took place last Monday. What's been going on? There was a big concert at the Festival Hall, wasn't there?
Yes, there was. And I think all my works practically have been played. And luckily, not a great... I didn't write music every minute.
Well, that was a good long evening if they played the whole lot. And there have been a whole lot of other broadcasts of not quite such an elaborate nature, such as Composer of the Week and...
That's good. Makes a little money.
Of course. Oh, yes. Well, that's the object of having a birthday. It's a birthday present, isn't it?
It is, yes.
Well, we got your last record. What's that going to be?
It's a nice, noisy recording of Belshazzar's Feast, conducted by Andre Proven. And that he does it very well.
Closing passage of Belshazzar's Feast, the London Symphony Orchestra and Chorus, conducted by Andre Previn. If you could take only one disc of the eight, which would it be?
Well, it wouldn't be that, but it's too loud.
What would it be?
Probably the violin concerto.
Your own violin concerto. And you're allowed to take one luxury to the island, any one thing you would like to have of no practical use.
A funicular.
A funicular, a railway.
Yeah, because you see our garden's on the side of a hill.
Yes.
And it's a great, great walk if you go up by the steps I used to do when I was young. We used to. But my mother-in-law objected. I objected too.
So you've got this little...
I've got a little funicular.
Yes.
Just for two people.
For two people.
Mm-hmm.
And you think this is going to be a hilly island?
Well, it's bound to be. I mean, all the islands around there are hilly.
All right. We'll arrange that it shall be for two people, just in case anybody else turns up.
Quite.
And one book. You have the Bible and Shakespeare. And one other book. What would you like?
Besides those?
Yes.
Well, as I've taken this interest rather late in life, I've taken this interest in garden, I should take The Education of a Gardener by Russell Page.
The Education of a Gardener.
A Gardener.
By Russell Page.
Russell Page.
Who designed your garden?
Yes.
Splendid. Of course you shall have that.
fight in France. We shall fight on the seas and oceans. We shall fight with growing confidence and growing strength in the air. We shall defend our island, whatever the cost may be. We shall fight on the beaches. We shall fight on the landing grounds. We shall fight in the fields and in the streets. We shall fight in the hills. We shall never surrender.
Thank you, Sir William Walton, for letting us hear your Desert Island disc.
Thank you very much, and it's been a great pleasure talking. Sure.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Goodbye, everyone.
Thank you.